Got to transfer all my notes to a new copy of this book. When you open book four, you should immediately notice something that's different from the previous three books. What is it? Doesn't start with Harry, okay. What else? It's true. It's part of it.
It kind of leads to like...
Okay. Where do books one through three begin? Number four, Privet Drive. Book four, we're not even near number four, Privet Drive. Okay. One through three are published 97, 98, 99. Okay. This one comes out summer of 2000. Yeah, July of 2000. Okay. And it's immediately darker than the first three books. Because what do we witness in the opening chapter in this book that we haven't seen in one through three?
Murder.
We see a murder. Okay. Austin, I know you're on here somewhere.
You're down the bottom, probably.
There you are. Yeah, we witnessed a murder. Okay. We also witnessed Lord Voldemort doing it. We were not quite sure how. Okay. So, open to the first chapter. And we get this description of Little Hangleton and the Riddle House and what had happened many years ago, okay, about Frank Bryce. And we kind of jump up to the present on page four. The wealthy man who owned the Riddle House these days neither lived there nor put it to any use. They said in the village he kept it for tax reasons. In other words, it's a fairly large house, and so it's a tax write-off. Frank Bryce is kept on as the gardener slash caretaker. Frank is nearing his 77th birthday. Okay, he came back from the war, World War II, a little different. Who wouldn't? Okay, and he lives in kind of the gardener's shack, let's say, or the gardener's house, okay? He still keeps up the old place. And we're told on page five, it's Frank's leg, his bad leg, that woke him up. He got up, he limped downstairs into the kitchen, fills his hot water bottle, standing at the sink. He looks up at the Riddle House and he sees lights in upstairs windows. He knew what was going on. Some kids had broken in and started a fire. So, he's going to go kick them out. Notice, page six. Frank goes up to the house. The front door of the Riddle House bore no sign of being forced, nor did any of the windows. So you immediately start to wonder, well, okay, how did these kids get in then? Frank clipped around to the back of the house until he reached a door almost completely hidden by ivy, took out the old key, put it into the lock, and opened the door noiselessly. Okay, why the detail for the door is almost hidden by ivy? What's that telling us?
It's old.
It's
a long time.
It's old?
It's not really keeping up with the garden.
Okay, what else though?
It's hidden.
Is it used?
No.
If it's hidden by ivy, if you've ever seen an old house like this, where, you know, here's a doorway, and the whole thing's almost obscured. Notice, Frank pulls the old key out, puts it into the door, and the door opens how?
Noiselessly.
Noiselessly. Really?
So it's purposely hidden.
How long has that door probably not been used? Possibly, I would say probably, since the Riddles died. Is that door going to open noiselessly?
No.
Only way a door opens noiselessly is if these hinges are regularly oiled. If the door hasn't been oiled, well, let's say it doesn't even go back as far as the Riddles' death. Let's say it only goes back 10 years. That door is going to open difficultly. You're going to have to go, okay? There's a problem here in her writing, okay? She wants it to open noiselessly. Why?
So he can actually sneak in.
So he can sneak in so that whoever is upstairs doesn't hear him. But it's like she doesn't think of the ramifications of the door not having been opened for many, many years. Okay? So, Frank goes in. Lost my place. He goes into the cavernous kitchen. Notice, he had not entered it for many years. Nevertheless, although it was very dark, he remembered where the door into the hall was, and he groped his way toward it, his nostrils full of the smell of decay, ears pricked for any sound of footsteps. Okay? He reaches the hall, a little lighter because there's lots of windows, and he starts to go up the stairs. Notice, blessing the dust that lay thick upon the stone. This is telling us, Frank, I almost said Sam for some reason. Frank hasn't been in the house for years. If there's this thick layer of dust, okay, then there's going to be rust on these hinges. So he makes his way up the landing, and he hears a couple of voices speaking. And I'm going to skip some of this. The second voice says, "Move me closer to the fire, Wormtail." Frank puts his good ear to the door. He hears a bottle being put down, and he hears a voice say, "Where is Nagini?" I don't know, my lord. She set out to explore the house, I think. "You will milk her before we retire, Wormtail. I will need feeding in the night. The journey has tired me greatly." How do you milk a snake? Anybody know? The fangs. Okay? A venomous snake has poison glands just behind its fangs, and you push those down onto the edge of a glass, and the venom comes out. So, what keeps Voldemort alive?
Snake venom?
Brow furrowed, Frank inclines his good ear still closer to the door. He's thinking, what? Wormtail asks, "My lord, may I ask how long we are going to stay here?" "A week." Hold on one second. "A week, perhaps longer. Not until the Quidditch World Cup is over." Okay. They keep talking. And Wormtail says, page 8. "It could be done without Harry Potter, my lord."
"Without Harry Potter?"
"I do not say this out of concern for the boy. The boy is nothing to me, nothing at all. It is merely if we were to use another witch or wizard, any wizard, the thing could be done so much more quickly." Notice, if we could use another witch or wizard, any wizard. Okay. Assuming, for the moment, that everybody knows how this novel ends. Has everybody read this before? Or almost everybody? Okay. So we can jump back and forth without giving away stuff. "Can any witch or wizard be used for the purposes that Voldemort needs?"
No.
Okay. "Can any witch or wizard be used for the purposes that Voldemort needs?" Yes. Any witch or wizard can.
Except for a Death Eater.
Well, in terms of the spell, what's the spell? Why does what does he say when he uses Harry's blood?
"Blood from the enemy."
"Blood from my enemy." Okay. Except for a Death Eater. What are most witches and wizards? Enemies of Voldemort. Okay. So, you know, any Tom, Dick, or Harry witch or wizard let's say they're a transvestite, witches and wizards, you know, wouldn't matter. But he wants Harry's in particular for a very particular reason. Does Wormtail understand that reason possibly at this point? No. Yes.
This is kind of an extraneous question, which you can brush aside if you want to. Okay. Do you have a theory as to how Voldemort got this body that he's in right now?
No.
Because I read a fan theory that it came from Bertha Jorkins, and it totally freaked me out. Because that's so demented.
No, I don't think it'd be. I don't think it would be that, because one, we're not given a real description of the body that he has, other than that later when it gets dropped into the cauldron, it looks like a little deformed baby.
That was the theory.
But, you know, that wouldn't be Bertha Jorkins. I think what's possibly better than that is you have to jump to book 7, to the chapter King's Cross.
Yeah.
And what Harry sees under the little bench or under the little seat. The fragment of the real Voldemort's that's left is kind of what this is.
So I guess I just wonder, like, what keeps him, like, in an actual physical body as opposed to, like, when he was at the end of...
When he was attached to Quirrell's head?
Right, or, like, after he had to flee from Godric's Hollow and he wasn't really in a body then either.
Yeah, he was spirit.
Right.
He was spirit then. But what's been happening since then? Let's say, since when he flees Godric's Hollow... Now, what, 14 years ago? He's gaining power. So, as he gains in power, it's kind of like he gains materiality. Yeah, he gains solidity. I think a more important question is, where does he get his wand?
That is a good question.
I mean, what happened to Voldemort when he cursed Harry? Poof! He disappears. What happens to his wand? There's nothing to hold on to it anymore. Okay? So, when Voldemort disappears...
Wormtail went to the house. You think he got it?
He must have. So, Wormtail's been hiding Voldemort's wand for all these years.
Like.
You know, sticking in a crook in a tree or something. I mean, it's one of those questions that is never answered. Never. Does she, in the books, now she might come up with some fanciful theory on Pottermore, but in the books she never comes up with an explanation for how Voldemort got his wand back, or who preserved or saved his wand, okay? Anyway, they go on. Voldemort, I could use another wizard. That's true. My lord, it makes sense. Look at the language that Voldemort then used, Wormtail then uses. If any of you are in any, how do I want to put this? Particularly religious, let's say in the Christian sense, or devout, you know, you go to church every week, etc. You might recognize this terminology. Laying hands on Harry Potter would be so difficult. He is so well protected. Laying hands is religious terminology. It usually implies blessing. Okay? According to the, you know, variety of the writers of the New Testament, St. Paul in particular, you lay hands on somebody to anoint them for some great task, etc. What does Wormtail, however, mean by laying hands on? Abducting, kidnapping. But she doesn't say kidnapping or abducting. It's kind of weird that she uses this particular terminology, because we're going to see in book 7, I think it is, yeah, it's in book 7, we're going to hear Voldemort himself talking about pious thickness converting people at the Ministry of Magic. And he actually uses that word. Okay? Again, that's religious terminology. You don't talk about, you know, Republicans converting to be Democrats, or Democrats converting to be Republicans. You talk about them changing their minds, changing their political opinions. You talk about people changing their religious beliefs to conversion. I converted to Islam. I converted to Christianity. I converted to Buddhism, whatever. Okay? So she starts using this kind of religious language here. And so you volunteer to go and fetch me a substitute. I wonder, Wormtail, could this suggestion of abandoning the plan be nothing more than an attempt to desert me? My lord, I have no wish to leave you, none at all. Do not lie to me. I can always tell. I revolt you. Well, yeah. Because from the description we're given, he would be revolting. I mean, his skin is raw and red-looking, like he's been flayed. That is, the outer layer of skin has been removed. Eyes are slits. The nose is a slit. What eyes and nose he has? No, my devotion. Religious language again. To your lordship. Your devotion is nothing more than cowardice. Is it? What did Sirius and Remus say? You were always a coward. You always hung around only with what? Those with power to protect you. Okay? And he says, Remus, Sirius, you don't understand the tools the Dark Lord has. He would have killed me. And what did they say? Black, in fact, said, then you should have died, Peter. Finish the quote.
Better to die than betray friends.
As we would have died for you. Okay? Sirius is telling us there. 13 years ago, Peter, I would have sacrificed my life for you. Strange. Okay? You would not be here if you had anywhere else to go. How am I to survive without you when I need feeding every few hours? Who is to milk Nagini? But you seem much stronger. Liar. Okay? So, he goes on and says, I have my reasons for using the boy, as I've already explained to you. So, he's explained to Wormtail why he wants to use Harry. I've waited 13 years. A few more months will make no difference. As for the protection surrounding the boy, my plan will be effective. Why? You got to jump to the end of the novel and jump to the, you know, really, the end of book 7. Why will the plan be effective? Because he'll now have that same protection. Harry's mother died to save Harry. If Harry's blood, what did Dumbledore say? Her sacrifice is flowing through your veins, Harry. When he says your mother died to protect you and it left a mark on you, Harry's kind of like, where? No, not a visible mark. He said her protection flows through your veins. So, using the blood of Harry Potter, that protection will flow through his veins. He doesn't see, however, it will also be his undoing. Why doesn't he see that? What does Voldemort have no knowledge of?
Oh, did he marry?
Nope. Love. Love. Okay? So, they talk about Bertha Jorkins. And Voldemort says, if you follow the plan, you'll do it quietly without fuss. By that time, my faithful servant will have rejoined us. Wormtail, I am a faithful servant. He says, kind of like a sullen little spoiled child. Wormtail, I need somebody with brains. Somebody whose loyalty has never wavered. And you, unfortunately, fulfill neither requirement. I found you. I was the one who found you. I brought you Bertha Jorkins, or Jorkins. Okay. What should Wormtail be doing here? What does he mean when he says, I found you, I brought you Bertha Jorkins? What else could he say? I saved you. I rescued you. If he hadn't brought Bertha Jorkins to him, what kind of plan would he have? None. None. Okay? That is true. Stroke of brilliance. I would not have thought possible from you. Wormtail, though, truth be told, you were not aware how useful she would be when you caught her, were you, Bob? Okay. And he says, I will allow you to perform an essential task for me, one that many of my followers would give their right hands to perform. Nice little bit of foreshadowing. Really, my lord? Oh, no, I'll tell you when the time comes. You're going to kill me, too? Why would I kill you? I killed Bertha because I had to. She was fit for nothing after my questioning. Quite useless. In other words, what happened to her? She went the way of Frank and Alice Longbottom. Okay. So, they keep talking. And Frank's standing out there listening to all this. And he's thinking, the man with the cold voice that killed a woman, he's talking about it without any kind of remorse. He was dangerous. And this boy, Harry Potter, whoever he was in danger too. Frank knew what he must do. Frank turns and looks behind him. Big giant snake. Okay? And Voldemort tells Wormtail, there's a muggle outside, invite him in. So Frank is invited into the room. You heard everything, muggle, says Voldemort, page 14. And let's say you're calling me. I'm calling you a muggle. It means you are not a wizard. I don't know what you mean by wizard. All I know is I've heard enough to interest the police tonight. You've done murder, you're planning more. My wife knows I'm up here, and if I don't come back, you have no wife. Nobody knows you're here. You told nobody that you were coming. Do not lie to Lord Voldemort, muggle, for he knows. He always knows. It's not quite clear that he always knows, however. We'll talk about that later. So Frank says, my lord, is it? Well, then turn around and face me like a man. But I'm not a man, muggle. I am much, much more than a man. What does Voldemort mean by that? Think the Nietzsche material that you were supposed to have read. He's the Superman. He's the overman. That is kind of the next evolutionary leap. He is not to be bound by the common laws that bind other wizards or even down below them, us muggles. So he says, turn me around, Wormtail. Just one second, Olivia. The servant gave a whimper. Why? Well, I don't think so. I don't think Wormtail cares about, you know, people dying. After all, Wormtail killed 13 muggles. It's that he's going to have to face Voldemort. He's going to have to see him in the chair when he turns him around. Okay? There's a flash of green light. Frank Bryce crumples to the ground, and Harry Potter awakes with a start. Olivia?
Do we have to find out who memory charmed Bertha Jorkins? Why was she under a memory charm that Voldemort had to break?
No, we don't.
That just seems weird to me. Like, she's just a random ministry employee. Why was she under a memory charm?
Is that why she always got lost?
No, I don't think so. Let me go back here for a second.
Some investor of, like, Wolverine. She can't keep track of anything now.
She wouldn't have been one that Gilderoy had done that to because, I mean...
No, I was just joking, like,
some extra
up like Gilderoy.
Yeah, because Sirius is going to say later on she was useless.
Yeah.
You know, she was a kind of a mindless, nameless bureaucrat.
That's just why it seems really weird that she would have been memory charmed.
Take that back. Yes, we do get an answer. If I remember correctly, it's... Barty Crouch Jr. when he's pretending to be his father at the ministry.
Okay.
I think. So Harry wakes up. Scar is hurting. He's remembering this dream. Voldemort was there. Wormtail was there. He doesn't know who the old man was. They'd been talking about murdering somebody, him. And so he starts to think, what should I do? What should I do? And so he kind of runs through his head. I could write messages to my friends. So let's see. What would Hermione say? Ooh, your scar hurt, page 21. That's really serious. Write to Professor Dumbledore, and I'll go look it up in a book, okay, about cursed scars. The only problem is, what is a book going to say about somebody who'd been cursed with Avada Kedavra and their scar hurt them?
Nothing.
Yeah, because there's nobody like that in a book, okay? So, dear Professor Dumbledore, sorry to bother you, but my scar hurt this morning. Yours sincerely, Harry Potter. And Harry thinks, lame. So, Ron, your scar hurt? What, do you know who? Can't be near you, can he? I mean, you know, wouldn't you? He'd be trying to do you in again, wouldn't he? I don't know, Harry. Maybe cursed scars always twinge a bit. I'll ask Dad. Yeah, like Arthur's going to know anything. You know, if it doesn't have to do with an electrical outlet or some other muggle artifact, Arthur's pretty useless. Okay? Even though he is a fully qualified wizard who worked in the misuse of muggle artifacts at the Ministry of Magic. So, Harry thinks, serious. Alright? And so he writes Sirius a little note. Thanks for your last letter. That bird was enormous. Could hardly get through my window. Things are same as usual here. Dudley's diet isn't going too well. My aunt found him smuggling donuts into his room yesterday. They told him they'd have to cut his pocket money if he keeps doing it, so he got really angry, chucked his PlayStation out of the window. It's a sort of computer thing you can play games on, but it's a bit stupid, really. Now he hasn't even got Mega Mutilation Part 3 to take his mind off things. And so he talks about his scar. My scar hurt again. Last time that happened, it was because Voldemort was at Hogwarts. You know, cursed scars sometimes hurt years afterwards. Okay? He gets the next chapter. He gets the invitation to go to the Quidditch World Cup. And Vernon says, okay. And chapter 4, back to the Burrow. The time comes that they're supposed to arrive, and Vernon's looking out at the door, and they're not showing up. But then Harry hears a noise, pages 42-43, and we're told, but they were left in doubt barely a second longer. Voices could be heard from inside the blocked fireplace. Notice, the Weasleys didn't tell Harry how they were coming. Because if they said, we're going to come by flu powder, what would Harry have told them? No, you can't do that. Because the fireplace has been completely covered up. All right? So, Mr. Weasley blasts a hole in the wall so they can come out. Pages 44 and 45. Words utterly failed Uncle Vernon. His best suit was covered in white dust, which had settled in his hair and mustache and made him look as though he had just aged 30 years. Mr. Weasley, yes, sorry about that. It's all my fault. Just didn't occur to me we couldn't be able to get through. So Harry's kind of taking in this scene. The Dursleys covered with powdered dust, and the Weasley stepping out of a fireplace into this thoroughly muggle home. So, Harry gets his trunk and such, and the brothers help him get it out. So, Fred and George go, and Fred, just before he goes, accidentally drops a bag of sweets. Starts to pick them back up and leaves. Okay, George goes with the trunk. And page 48, Harry says, by then, to the Dursleys. They don't say anything at all. Harry goes towards the fire. He almost gets to the hearth, and Mr. Weasley puts out an arm and stops him. Harry said goodbye to you. Didn't you hear him? Harry, it doesn't matter. Honestly, I don't care. Mr. Weasley did not remove his hand from Harry's shoulder. You aren't going to see your nephew till next summer. Surely you're going to say goodbye. What is Mr. Weasley doing? He's teaching manners. Okay. Two, a contemporary, somebody his own age. To the Dursleys. Uncle Vernon's face worked furiously. That is, it made a variety of movements. The idea of being taught consideration. Notice what he's wrestling with. This is like Gollum at, you know, Kirith Ungol, looking up, coming back, torn. The idea of being taught consideration by a man who just blasted away half his living room wall seemed to be causing him intense suffering. Notice, being taught consideration. What does that mean? Consideration. To be considerate is what it means. Okay? To be taught how to be considerate by somebody who just blew apart half his living room. He was having real difficulty working that out. But Mr. Weasley's wand was still in his hand. Uncle Vernon notices. Harry, see you, after Vernon says, goodbye then. Okay. But Harry hears a noise, and Dudley is no longer standing behind his parents. He's kneeling beside the coffee table. Why? Because he saw the bag of sweets. And he grabbed some and put it in his mouth. And now his tongue is growing to be, 4 feet long, I think, by the time it's all said and done. So Mr. Weasley fixes Dudley, fixes the wall, goes back home. And we hear Fred and George laugh and such. We're going to skip a bunch. Let's see. We hear about Percy talking about Mr. Crouch, this and that. And we get chapter 6, the portkey. Like I said, I'm trying to cover a lot of material. And so we have a new device introduced into the wizarding world, or into our understanding of the wizarding world. Harry and the Weasleys go off to meet Amos and Cedric Diggory, okay, at the portkey. And page 71 is where we meet the Diggorys. Mr. Weasley says, this is Amos Diggory, works for the Department for the Regulation and Control of Magical Creatures. In other words, have we already been introduced to him kind of in a nameless fashion?
Yes.
Right? Because that's the department that would have looked into Buckbeak's charges. Okay? And I think you know his son Cedric. Cedric Diggory was an extremely handsome boy of around 17, captain and seeker of the Hufflepuff House Quidditch team at Hogwarts. Hi, Cedric, or hi, says Cedric, looking around. Everybody says hi back except for Fred and George. Why do Fred and George not say hi back to Cedric?
Because he's on the opposing Quidditch team.
Okay. Why else?
I caught the snitch when Harry fell.
Pretty boy Cedric defeated them when Harry, fell. They had never quite forgiven Cedric for beating their team in the first Quidditch match of the previous year. Okay? So, Amos and Arthur talk for a bit, and Amos realizes, here's Harry Potter right in front of him. Merlin's beard! Harry Potter? Yeah. Sense talked about you, of course. told us all about playing against you last year. I said to him, I said, Sid, that'll be something to tell your grandchildren, that will. You beat Harry Potter. Harry couldn't think of any reply to this, so he remained silent. Fred and George are scowling. Cedric looked slightly embarrassed. Harry fell off his broom, Dad. I told you, it was an accident. Yeah, why did Harry fall off his broom? Because there are about 100 Dementors looking up at him. Yes, but you didn't fall off, did you? In other words, Cedric's defeat of Harry Potter is what for Amos?
Ragnarok.
Yeah. He is living vicariously through his son. And thus, I beat Harry Potter. You know, always modest, R said, always the gentleman, unlike his father. But the best man won. I'm sure Harry'd say the same, wouldn't you? One falls off his broom, one stays on. Don't need to be a genius to tell which one's the better flyer. Okay. What are we going to be told about Harry's flying at the beginning of the Triwizard Tournament? We're going to hear Ludo Bagman say this.
He's the best.
He's going to say something like, "Great Scott, look at him fly. Are you watching this, Mr. Crumb?" Okay. Mr. Crumb, with a seeker for the Bulgarian national team, one of the greatest players in the world, and he's going to say, "Better watch out, because this kid's going to be beating you someday." Okay. So they find the port key, and it magically takes them to the Quidditch World Cup. And we get Bagman and Crouch. Okay. Notice we meet the Roberts family, page 77. Mr. Roberts has his mind wiped. "Obliviate," he says, sharply pointing his wand at Mr. Roberts. And suddenly Mr. Roberts' eyes kind of slip out of focus and he's fine. Okay. So we see them walk off, and we see little Kevin, page 81, taking his daddy's wand and doing what? Making slugs get big and shrink and big and shrink until he actually pops one. Kind of gross. We see a Bulgarian flag. We see Ron, you know, with his hero worship. I'm going to skip a bunch. We meet Ludo Bagman, and here, page 89, Mr. Weasley asked Ludo if there's been any news of Bertha Jorkins. Why? Because Bertha Jorkins works for the same department as Ludo, the Department of International Magical Cooperation, which is putting on the Triwizard Tournament, a.k.a. the Olympics. Okay. Kind of, Triwizard Tournament, but it's also putting on the Quidditch World Cup. We see Mr. Crouch, and we get to the actual Quidditch World Cup. Page 97. Harry gets up to his seat, prime seats, we're told, and he sees a house elf, Dobby. "Did Sarah just call me Dobby?" "Harry, sorry, just thought you were someone I knew. But I know it's Dobby too, sir. My name is Winky, sir, and you are surely Harry Potter." "Yes, I am, but Dobby talks of you all the time, sir. Harry, how is he? How's freedom suiting him?" Right? Harry freed Dobby at the end of book two. He hasn't heard or seen Dobby in book three. "Oh, sir, I is not sure you did Dobby a favor when you were setting him free." "Harry, why? What's wrong?" "Freedom is going to Dobby's head, sir. Ideas above his station. Can't get another position." What kind of position is Winky talking about? No, he can't get another position, meaning he can't be enslaved. Again, why? Because he's kind of liking freedom. He's wanting paying work. "Harry, why shouldn't he be paid?"
house else is not paid, sir. No, no, no. I says to Dobby, I says, go find yourself a nice family. Settle down, Dobby. You know, what could Dobby do? Think about this for a moment.
Anything.
He'd go work for Harry.
Yeah.
Would Harry be a mean master? Would Harry enslave him? Would Harry give him days off? Yes. Would Harry pay him? No, because Harry doesn't have any money. Real world, muggle world. I mean, he's got plenty of. Harry, it's about time you had a bit of fun. House elves are not supposed to have fun, Harry Potter. House elves does what they is told. Oh, not liking heights at all. In other words, Winky doesn't want to be where she is, but she was told to be there. Okay? Why are you up here? Master wants me to save him a seat. Harry Potter, he's very busy. Ron, so that's a house elf, huh? Harry, Dobby was weirder. So, we see the Malfoys come up. We see Fudge try to explain to the Bulgarian Prime Minister, or Minister of Magic, who Harry is. Harry Potter, you know. Harry Potter, oh, come on, page 100. You know who he is. The boy who survived. You know who. The Bulgarian wizard suddenly spotted Harry's scar and started gabbling. Gabbling? Huh. Loudly and excitedly. Knew we'd get there in the end, said Fudge wearily to Harry. Okay. And that's when Harry sees the Malfoys. Harry and Draco had been enemies ever since their very first journey to Hogwarts. Pale boy with a pointed face, white blonde hair, Draco greatly resembled his father. Notice the description, by the way, of Draco and his father. They match perfectly Hitler's whole idea of the Aryan race. She does that very intentionally. I mean, blonde hair, blue eyes, pale complexion. His mother was blonde too, tall, slim. She would have been nice looking if she hadn't been wearing a look that suggested there's a nasty smell under her nose. So she's walking around kind of with a pinched look on her face. All right. Fudge introduces Malfoy to Arthur Weasley. You know Arthur Weasley, I dare say. Good Lord, Arthur. What did you have to sell to get seats in the top box? Surely your house wouldn't have fetched this much. And what does Fudge say? Because he wasn't listening, Lucius has just given a very generous contribution to St. Mungo's Hospital for Magical Maladies and Injuries, Arthur. He's here as my guest. You know, we hear all kinds of talk politically today about what? Too much money in elections. How money greases the skids and gets, you know, favors done. What's Malfoy doing? Currying favor. How? By making large donations. Mr. Weasley, how nice. Malfoy looks at Hermione, who went slightly pink but stared determinedly back at him. Way to go, Hermione. Because we know what's going on in Malfoy's mind. What's he thinking? Mudblood. That's what he's thinking. Run. Slimy gits. So, we actually see the Quidditch World Cup. I'm going to skip all the stuff about the Vila. And what actually happens in the World Cup is not all that important, other than, you know, Ireland wins. And then we get chapter 9, the Dark Mark. Okay? Page 118. They've gone off to their tent. Harry and Ron are in their bunk beds. And we hear noise going on outside. And we hear, get up, Ron, Harry, get up now. What's the matter? Just grab a jacket. Get outside. Harry did as he was told. They go outside. And what do they see? They see people running off to the woods, and they can see them because of the light of fires. But then they also see a crowd of wizards, page 119, tightly packed and moving together with wands pointing straight upward. Okay? They're tightly packed almost like a Greek phalanx, okay? But rather than having spears pointing outward with shields, they've got wands pointing upward. So Harry, you know, follows where the wands are pointed. High above them, floating along in midair, four struggling creatures were being contorted into grotesque shapes. It was as though the masked wizards on the ground were puppeteers and the people above them were marionettes, operated by invisible strings that rose from the wands into the air. Two of the figures were very small. More figures are joining that group. That is, even though some people are running off to the woods, this crowd is getting larger and larger. Tents crumple and fall as the marching crowd swells. That is, physical things don't even get in their way. Harry suddenly sees the floating people illuminated, and he notices it's the Roberts family. The other three are his wife and children. One of the marchers below flipped Mrs. Roberts upside down with his wand. Her nightdress fell down to reveal voluminous drawers, and she struggled to cover herself up as the crowd below screeched and hooted with glee. "Ron, that's sick. That is really sick." Okay? So Mr. Weasley says, "We're going to help the ministry." Harry, Ron, Hermione go off to the woods. Ron trips over a tree root on his way. Page 121. "Well, with feet that size, hard not to," says Malfoy. Ron says something in unprintable language. "Language, Weasley. Hadn't you better be hurrying along now? You wouldn't like her spotted, would you?" He points or nods at Hermione. "Hermione, what's that supposed to mean? Granger, they're after muggles. Do you want to be showing off your knickers in midair? Because if you do, hang around. They're moving this way, and it would give us all a laugh." "Harry, Hermione's a witch. Have it your own way. Own way, Potter. If you think they can't spot a mudblood, stay where you are." Okay? So, Harry, Ron, and Hermione go off to the woods. And let's see, skip here a bit. They see Winky. Winky says there is bad wizards about. They go off deeper and deeper into the wood looking for Fred and George and Ginny. Harry tells Ron, page 127, "Imagine if your dad catches Lucius Malfoy. He's always said he'd like to get something on him." And then 128, they hear a voice, and Harry says, "Who's there?" And all of a sudden they hear, "Mors Mordre." Big green flash. They look up at the sky, and there's a giant skull. Page 129, "It's the Dark Mark," Hermione moans. "You know whose sign? Voldemort's? Harry, come on." Okay. They run across the clearing. Harry whirled around, and in an instant, he registered one fact. Each of these wizards had his wand out. As they're running, they stop because Harry hears as all these wizards apparate. And notice, it's Harry that realizes not only have they apparated, but what else? They've all got their wands out. They're all pointed at the middle of the clearing. Now think about this for a moment. You've got Harry, Ron, Hermione, and these wizards are all lined up around them, and they're pointing their wands. What do you call this?
Crossfight.
Circular firing squad. Think about it. Harry, Ron, Hermione, duck. You know, they start taking each other out, which is, you know, Harry, Ron, and Hermione do duck. Without pausing to think, he yelled, "Duck," and he pulls the other two down. Okay? So, Mr. Crouch comes in. "Which of you did it? Which of you conjured the Dark Mark?" "Harry, we didn't do that." "Ron, we didn't do anything. What do you want to attack us for?" "Do not lie, sir." And the witch goes, Birdie, they're kids. "Where did the mark come from?" asks Mr. Weasley. Hermione points. Okay. So Barty Crouch goes over there. Mr. Diggory comes out and says, "We found them. There's someone here unconscious. It's Mr. Crouch. Who? Who is it?" Winky. Mr. Crouch is off. "No, this can't be. No point, Mr. Crouch. There's no one else there." Diggory, "Wow, a bit embarrassing. You know, Barty Crouch's house elf." "Mr. Weasley, come off it, Amos. You don't think seriously it was the elf. The dark mark's a wizard sign. It requires a wand." She had a wand. "What?" Pulls out the wand Winky had. Okay, we find out it's Harry's. Mr. Diggory speaks to Winky, page 134. Winky says, "Hoy's not doing it, sir. Hoy's not knowing how. You were found with a wand in your hand. Harry, that's mine." Okay. Winky says again, "I wasn't doing it." Harry, Ron, and Hermione all say it was a human voice that uttered the incantation. Page 136. They do prior incantato, and they see the spell come back out of the wand. So they know the wand was used. Okay. And Mr. Diggory just kind of, he's getting agitated and getting excited. He says, "You've been caught red-handed, elf," page 136. "Caught with the guilty wand in your hand." Mr. Weasley, "Amos, think about it. Precious few wizards know how to do that spell. Where would she have learned it?" Mr. Crouch finishes the thought. "Perhaps Amos is suggesting that I routinely teach my servants to conjure the dark mark." Mr. Crouch, not at all. What does this show us on Amos Diggory's part? Especially in relation to Barty Crouch. Doesn't like him? Okay, maybe a lower status. He's afraid of him. Okay, we're going to find out very quickly why. You have now come very close to accusing the two people in this clearing who are least likely to conjure that mark. Harry Potter and myself. I suppose you're familiar with the boy story. Like, who isn't, other than maybe Gilderoy Lockhart? Of course, everyone knows. And I trust you remember the many proofs I have given over a long career that I despise and detest the dark arts and those who practice them. We don't know what that means at this point. We'll come to know what it means later on. I never suggested you had anything to do with it. If you accuse my elf, you accuse me, Diggory. Where else would she have learned to conjure it? Could have picked it up anywhere. Precisely. Where did you find Harry's wand? And she says, "I was finding it in the trees." Okay. So, what does Barty Crouch do? Is Winky guilty of anything? Yes, she is. She is guilty of one thing. She had a wizard's wand in her hand. Okay? It's because of that and the aspersions that get cast on Barty Crouch because of her having that wand in her hand and because that wand was used to create the dark mark that Barty Crouch releases her. Okay? What did we already hear Winky say earlier about a house elf's reason for being? They live for what?
Serve their house master.
To serve their master. Okay? Winky speaks of a house elf's enslavement as if it is not really enslavement. Okay? It's because of what happens to Winky that Hermione does what?
Starts spew.
Okay, the proper way to pronounce it. What does Rowling do with spew from here to the end of the series?
Nothing.
I mean, Hermione tries, bless her heart. She tries. She tries to free the house elves. But what must she do in order to make them free?
Convince them that they need to be free.
Keep going. Convince them of what?
That they would be better off if they weren't
Okay? Put that in a negative way. To convince them that they live horrid, wretched lives. Okay? Now, Dobby said he lived a horrid, wretched life. But who did Dobby live with? See, the world isn't, as Sirius is going to say later about something else, the world isn't divided between Malfoys and Dursleys. Right? There are... It's okay. There are good wizards, and there are good muggles. Dobby had the bad fortune of being a house elf to the Malfoys. Just like Creature had the bad fortune of being a house elf to the Blacks. But then he's the house elf of Harry, and what does Harry do? He starts to treat him kindly. Does Harry release Creature?
No.
No, Creature is still, quote unquote, enslaved. But Harry doesn't treat him like a slave. What does he treat him like? How does he treat Dobby? Like an equal. Like an equal. Okay? Go on to Mayhem at the Ministry. So they go back to the borough, and we find out, page 146, Mrs. Weasley says, when they get back, holding the Daily Prophet, she says, "I've been so worried, so worried. You're all right. You're alive. Oh, boys." Okay. We find out about Rita Skeeter. Okay. A little bit. And we discover that Mr. Weasley is going in to the ministry as often now as he did when. When Voldemort was in power before, okay? Nice little indication that things are ratcheting up. And we get page 151. Mrs. Weasley glances at the grandfather clock. Harry liked this clock. It was completely useless if he wanted to know the time, but otherwise very informative. It had 9 golden hands. Each of them was engraved with one of the Weasley family's names. No numerals around the face, but descriptions of where each family member might be. Home, school, work, but also traveling, lost, hospital, prison. And in the midnight hour, mortal peril. Think about this clock for a moment. Would you really want that kind of clock in your home? Because what happens when one of the hands goes to mortal peril? What can you do? Nothing. Okay? Your father, page 152, hasn't had to go into the office on weekends since the days of you-know-who. They're working him far too hard. Percy! Well, father feels he's got to make up for his mistake at the match, doesn't he? Truth be told, he was a tad unwise to make a public statement without clearing it with his head of department first. His head of department? How many people work in Arthur's department?
2.
And the other guy isn't the head. I don't even think Arthur has a head of department, unless he is the head of the department. Okay? Don't you blame your father for what that wretched Skeeter woman wrote. If Dad hadn't said anything, old Rita would have just said it was disgraceful that nobody from the ministry had commented, said Bill. What is Percy showing us there?
That he's trying to pull away from his father.
That he feels better than his family?
Okay. Where's his ultimate allegiance lie?
Ministry of
Magic. It's not with his family. Dad was a tad unwise, he says. Why? Because he didn't get the ministry to tell him what to say. In other words, Arthur thinks for himself. He's not going to necessarily toe the ministry line, okay, which is going to lead to problems in books 5, 6, and 7. Let's go on to aboard the Hogwarts Express. Not getting near as far as I need to. We find out that Arthur has to go rescue Mad-Eye. And Harry, page 161, asks, who is Mad-Eye? Charlie, he's retired, used to work at the ministry. I met him once when Dad took me in to work with him. He was an Auror, one of the best, a dark wizard catcher. Half the cells in Azkaban are full because of him. He made himself loads of enemies, though. Families of people he caught mainly, and I heard he's been getting really paranoid in his old age. Doesn't trust anyone anymore. Sees dark wizards everywhere. Think of his job. Okay? He's like a spook, like a spy. What does he have to learn to do? Distrust everybody. I've got a brother-in-law who's an ex-cop. You know, go out to a restaurant and stuff. He would never sit with his back
to the door.
He always would find a place to sit where he could see everything. Why? It's called being observant. It's knowing what's coming at you. That's why when cops today, you know, you get pulled over for a ticket. When they get out of their vehicle, what do they immediately do? If you watch them in your rearview mirror, one hand will go where? Always on their sidearm. Always. Why? They're being prepared. Okay? Charlie kind of alludes to something, says, I might see you guys. So they get to platform 9 3/4, page 165, and they hear Draco talking to some friends. Father actually considered sending me to Durmstrang rather than Hogwarts, you know. He knows the headmaster, you see. Well, you know his opinion of Dumbledore. The man's such a mudblood lover. Durmstrang doesn't admit that sort of riffraff. Durmstrang takes a far more sensible line than Hogwarts about the dark arts. Durmstrang students actually learn them. Okay? So we learn about another school for magic. Durmstrang. The phrase Durmstrang comes from Sturm und Drang. Storm and stress is what that means. Okay? It's a reference to this kind of this movement in 19th century European literature that kind of puts people in a crucible. You know, one of the greatest examples of it in English literature is Wuthering Heights. Okay, Heathcliff and Catherine. You know, where you have this high romantic tension involved, but you get a lot of stress, and the stress is emphasized even in nature. Okay, so Durmstrang, storm and stress. What kind of school do you think this is going to be? Do you think it's going to be like Lake Wobegon, where everybody's above average? You know, you get a participation medal for every. No, it's not. It's going to be intense. It's going to be you learn or you fail. Okay, the other school that we're going to come to learn shortly about is Beauxbatons, Beauxbatons, which means beautiful wands or beautiful batons, if you want. Okay? What characterizes these students from Beauxbatons?
They're very delicate.
They're very delicate. They're pretty. The girls are, at least. I'm assuming the boys are, you know, handsome. Let's see here. Let's keep going on. So they get to the school, and we find out about the Triwizard Tournament. But before we do, we get a new Sorting Hat song. A thousand years or more ago, when I was newly sown, there lived four wizards of renown whose names are still well known. Bold Gryffindor from Wild Moor, Fair Ravenclaw from Glen, Sweet Hufflepuff from Valley Broad, Shrewd Slytherin from Fen. They shared a wish, a hope, a dream. They hatched a daring plan to educate young sorcerers, thus Hogwarts School began. Now each of these four founders formed their own house, for each did value different virtues in the ones they had to teach. Okay? So, 1,000 years or so ago, four renowned wizards come together to start a school. And within that school, they each form their own house. You can almost think of them as like colleges. And in those colleges, or in those houses, they value certain virtues. By Gryffindor, the bravest were prized far beyond the rest. Okay? That's a little bit different than what we heard in the first Sorting Hat song, where daring, nerve, and chivalry, okay, we were told. Gryffindor, the bravest, were prized far beyond the rest. For Ravenclaw, the cleverest, would always be the best. Hufflepuff, hard workers, okay. And power-hungry Slytherin loved those of great ambition. So, bravery, brains, hard work, ambition. While still alive, they did divide their favorites from the throng, the mass. Yet how to pick the worthy ones when they were dead and gone? 'Twas Gryffindor who found the way. He whipped me off his head. Who did the Sorting Hat belong to? Godric Gryffindor. The Sorting Hat is a relic of Godric Gryffindor in Book 7. And yet, and Book 6, and Book 5, and Book 4, 3, 2, and 1. And yet, Dumbledore is going to tell Harry, I think there's only one relic, only one surviving thing of Godric Gryffindor still around. The sword. And yet there's the hat. 'Twas Gryffindor who found the way. He whipped me off his head. The founders put some brains in me so I could choose instead. How did they put some brains in the hat? I think it's from the pensieve, or a pensieve. They pull off some thoughts, put it in, and those thoughts are the attributes of each of, you know, the founders, what they value the most. I don't think they literally put brains in, right? So I could choose instead. Now slip me snug about your ears. I've never yet been wrong. I'll have a look inside your mind and tell where you belong. Okay? It's benign. That is, there's nothing positive or negative about what the Sorting Hat says here. But in the next book, we're going to hear a new Sorting Hat song, and it's going to be decidedly negative. Where the Sorting Hat's going to say, I don't like what I have to do. So, we hear people sorted into various houses. And page 181, Hermione finds out that there are house elves working at Hogwarts. And nearly Headless Nick's like, well, how else did you think the food magically appeared? She thought it was magic, but it's not. It's invisible house elves who bring it, and where do they bring it from? Hermione never considered this. The kitchen's down in the basement. How do we know there have been kitchens? Yeah, but we haven't heard that yet. Because Dumbledore left a note with the invisibility cloak and then told him, your father used to use it to steal food from the kitchens. Okay? Has Harry gone off to look for the kitchens yet? No, he hasn't. So, page 182, Nick says, the largest number in any dwelling in Britain, over 100. Hermione, I've never seen one. Well, they hardly ever leave the kitchen by day, do they? That is, they're cooking, slaving away over hot stoves. They come out at night to do a bit of cleaning, see to the fire, so on. I mean, you're not supposed to see them, are you? That's the mark of a good house elf. isn't it? That you don't know it's there. Sometimes I think my children think that we have a house elf at home, and it's not how it works. But they get paid, Hermione says. They get holidays, don't they? And sick leave and pensions and everything. What does she sound like?
Mom.
Okay.
Harry.
No, she doesn't sound like Harry, I don't think. Okay, what kind of muggle? Let's talk politics for a moment.
She's an activist.
She's an activist. Okay. She's a community organizer. That's what she's talking about here. What's she going to do? She's going to organize the house elves. She's going to unionize them. Till they do what? Go on strike and demand for pay, for holiday leave, for sick leave. Do we ever hear anywhere that house elves get sick? No. They can get drunk. That's a bit different. Okay. Pensions? What do they need pensions for? Okay. Nearly headless neck chortles. Sick leave and pensions. House elves don't want sick leaves and pensions. Ron, oh, come on, Hermione, as his mouth is stuffed with food. Sorry, Harry, as he spits bits of Yorkshire pudding on Harry. You won't get them sick leave by starving yourself. Hermione, slave labor. That's what this is. Slave labor. Okay? Again, where does it ultimately come to? Nothing. And I kind of think that maybe Rowling might be gently suggesting something to the, I'm going to use a term here, the do-gooders of the world. The people who want to bring other people into a more enlightened state. But what must they do to enlighten those people? They must convince them that you live a wretched, horrible life. But are they convinced that they live a wretched, horrible life without anybody saying that to them? It's kind of like that scene in The Lord of the Rings when Aragorn talks about what the Rangers of the North do and how they protect the people, for example, of the Shire. And he says, and if they must remain simple and careless, then simple and careless meaning without any cares, then simple and careless they must be. But what, he doesn't mean that in the negative. He's saying, this is good that they live this way, that they don't understand the great big picture. How many of us would wish, rhetorical question here, don't answer it. How many of us would wish that maybe we could regain some of that innocence of youth? I say you guys are 20, 25 maybe, you know. I'm 54. I mean youth 5 to 10. For those 5 to 10-year-olds that still have innocence. Okay. Unfortunately, so much of public education today is designed to strip away that innocence, beginning with kindergarten. So, Dumbledore gives some rules, and he mentions the Triwizard Tournament. He introduces the new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher. Notice who comes in at just the right time, okay, knows how to make a grand entrance. And in talking about the Triwizard Tournament, he says, you know, there are new rules in place so that there won't be any deaths this year. Okay. But he also says, because of the Triwizard Tournament, there won't be any Quidditch this year. Okay. Dumbledore says there will be an age limit. Fred and George are like, we'll get past that. And then we get introduced to Mad-Eye Moody. Hagrid is still teaching. Let's see, I'm going to skip a bunch. Page 204. Our first real introduction to Mad-Eye Moody. Malfoy is taunting Ron because of Ron's father has led a raid on the Malfoys, a raid that was prompted by Moody and turned up nothing. And Harry says to Malfoy, page 204, "Get stuffed, Malfoy. Oh yeah, you were staying with them this summer, weren't you, Potter? So tell me, is his mother really that porky, or is it just the picture? Harry, you know your mother, Malfoy? That expression she's got, like she's got dung under her nose? Has she always looked like that? Or was that just because you were with her?" Malfoy's face goes slightly pink. "Don't you dare insult my mother. And keep your fat mouth shut then." Bang! Harry turns his back to Malfoy. And Malfoy tries to curse him. Harry felt something white hot graze the side of his face. He hears a second bang. He turns around and hears, "Oh, no, you don't, laddie." And there's Moody limping down the staircase. Wand was out, pointing at a pure white ferret, shivering on the stone-flagged floor, where Malfoy had been standing. "Did he get you?" "No, missed." "Leave it!" "Leave, not you, him." Crab is moving towards the ferret. Moody starts to limp toward Crab, Goyle, and the ferret, which gave a terrified speak and took off, streaking towards the dungeons. "I don't think so." And he points his wand at the ferret, and it goes 10 feet in the air. And it wham, smack down on the floor. Okay. We have a ferret in our house. Ferret falls from 10 feet. It's dead. They're very frail creatures. "I don't like people who attack when their opponent's back's turned. Stinking, cowardly, scummy thing to do." The ferret goes out. Wham! "Never do that again." "Professor Moody," McGonagall comes out. "Hello, Professor McGonagall. What are you doing? Teaching? Is that a student?" You know, and they're going off with the Scottish accents, you know. He goes, "Yep, no. Moody would never use transfiguration as a punishment. Surely Professor Dumbledore told you that. He might have mentioned it." What does this tell us about Moody? Rule schmools, you know. "I thought a good sharp shock would give detentions, Moody. Respect to the offenders out of house. What's Moody's idea of punishment? No pain, no gain. Okay? Detentions. Okay, Johnny, I'm going to put you in timeout. You're going to sit in that corner until you can learn to be good." Ain't going to work, folks. Okay? So Moody says, "Okay, I'll do that then. I'll speak to your head of house. You'd see, that would be Snape, wouldn't it?" "Yes, another old friend. Been looking forward to a chat with old Snape." Okay, and notice he says all this publicly. So that Harry and Ron are thinking, what's going on with Snape and Moody? Okay. Hermione starts to talk. Ron says, "Shh, why not? I want to fix that in my memory forever. Draco Malfoy, the amazing bouncing ferret." Okay. Oh, but he could have really hurt Malfoy. So they go off to their first defense against the dark arts classes with Moody. And how does he start? With a bang. "Unforgivable curses," he says. Okay. He says, "I'm going to put you under them." And Hermione's like, "But you can't do that." He says, "Fine, you can leave if you don't want to learn this." Straight into it, curses. "Now, according to the Ministry of Magic, page 211, I'm supposed to teach you counter curses and leave it at that. Not supposed to show you what illegal dark curses look like until you're in the sixth year. You're not supposed to be old enough to deal with it till then." "But Professor Dumbledore's got a higher opinion of your nerves. He reckons you can cope." Meaning what?
He spoke to Dumbledore about it.
Okay. Also, Dumbledore says, "The hell with the Ministry's standards." Okay. "I'm supposed to wait till your sixth year. You're only in your fourth year. But Dumbledore thinks you're ready." What's he saying? You're on the verge of adulthood. You need to know this stuff. Okay. So, do any of you know which curses are most heavily punished by wizarding law? Several hands go up. Ron, Imperius or something? Oh, yeah. Your father would know that one. Gave the ministry a lot of trouble at one time, the imperious curse. So, pulls out a drawer from his desk, pulls out a big jar with three spiders in it. Pulls out a spider. Imperio. And the spider leaps from Moody's hand on a fine thread of silk, begins to swing backward and forward. And then it starts to tap dance. And everybody laughs. Think it's funny, do you? You'd like it, would you, if I did it to you? Dead silence. Total control. I could make it jump out of the window, drown itself, throw itself down one of your throats. He says, years back, a lot of witches and wizards were being controlled by the Imperious Curse. Some job for the ministry. Doing what? Trying to sort out who was being forced to act and who was acting of their own free will. But it can be fought. What's it take? Constant vigilance. Okay? Another curse. Neville. Cruciatus, your name's Longbottom. Neville nods. Goes, spider needs to be bigger. Ingorgio, so he turns the spider. I always like to imagine it, you know, something pretty good size. Now larger than a tarantula. Depending on the tarantula, some tarantulas are as big as my hand, so I like to, you know, imagine like this. Curcio, spider curls over on its back and its legs just twitch. Hermione says, stop it. Pain. You don't need thumbscrews or knives to torture someone if you can perform the Cruciatus curse. That one was very popular once, too. All right, anybody else? Hermione. Says, yep, the last and the worst, the killing curse. Goes to pull the spider, and the spider's backing away because the spider knows what's coming. Okay. Flash of blinding green light, rushing sound as though a vast invisible something was soaring through the air. Instantaneously, the spider rolled over onto its back. Not nice, not pleasant, no counter curse, no blocking it. Only one known person has ever survived it, and he's sitting right in front of him. Boom! And all eyes go on Harry. And he's like, gee, thanks. Okay? So, they spend the rest of the next lesson, of that lesson, taking notes. Okay? And Moody offers Neville tea, takes him up to his room, because what was Neville doing during the Cruciatus curse? His hands were gripped to the front of his desk and his knuckles were white. That's why Hermione yelled, stop it. She was the only one apparently who noticed. Okay? Let's go on to 226 and we'll stop with this. Harry gets a note from Sirius. Fly north immediately. Snooze about your scars, the latest in a series of strange rumors that have reached me here. If it hurts again, go straight to Dumbledore. They're saying he's got Mad-Eye out of retirement, which means he's reading the signs. What kind of signs? Mars is bright tonight, we heard in the first book. Bertha Jorkins is missing. Dumbledore knows about Frank Bryce being missing. Okay. And Harry thinks, page 227, if Sirius came back and got caught, it would be his, Harry's, fault. What lesson did he not learn? The consequences of our actions, Harry, are multiple and various. Harry says at the end of book 3, if Voldemort returns to power, it'll be my fault. Why? Because I saved Peter Pettigrew. Completely taking out of the formula that Peter Pettigrew has a free will. Completely taking out of the formula that Sirius has a free will. Okay? Stop that. All right, we'll stop there and we'll pick up with chapter 15. On Thursday, which just means I'm going to try to cover more material.
Mary Catherine and Andrew. If you haven't started thinking about your term paper, you probably should.